Welcome back to Strictly Politics. In this segment, we are joined by Communications, Presidential Communications Development and Strategic Planning Secretary Ricky Carandang. I cannot even get your kilometric moniker right.
Don't worry, Linda. Sometimes I don't get it right. So, good evening.
Thank you, Secretary Carandang, for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Just you have to remember, this is my show, huh?
Yes, I know. I know.
Now, this is my show. But you've heard the criticisms. Let's go over them one by one. First, the fuel card. Critics appear seem to think that, you know, this is just going to be similar to the subsidies before, going to be eaten up by the future increases which we expect in the coming months or years. How does the government defend this?
Well, as we've said from the beginning when we announced it, this is a temporary measure to provide temporary relief to the transport operators. Why the transport operators? Because if they keep their fares low, then the public is spared from the increased fares, which means they're spared from higher prices of other commodities. So it creates a it sort of tempers the increase in prices. Remember, you don't have an unlimited amount of money, so you have to take the $450 million and put it where it's going to do the most good, given the limited resources. If you, for example, decide to subsidize fuel for everybody, nobody will feel it, and it won't have much of an effect. If you take the $450 million and you subsidize something else, it doesn't have the same kind of multiplier effect. But if you do public transport, that prevents increases in fares, at least for the time being, which means there's no increase in commodity prices as a result of the increase in fares. So again, it's a temporary solution until we put in place a longer-term solution.
But even at the outset, and even before you implemented it, there seem to be so many operational issues with it. First of all, it's not exactly a smart card. That's probably just, you know, the legalist being legalistic about it. Number two, who's to say who are the legitimate or the qualified drivers? As we know, we all have this colorum. Transport groups or transport owners.
Yeah. Actually, Linda, it's not as hard as the critics make it sound. They're trying to make it look so difficult, but it's not. The LTFRB, the Land Franchise Transportation Regulatory Board, has a list of legitimate transport operators, and they're the guys who are going to get...
That's not what I heard. The LTFRB list, I heard the last time, it's not exactly complete. They haven't tweeted out the colorums there.
Well, there are colorum vehicles that are not, well, by nature, because they have a franchise, then they're legitimate. Now, you can work around the edges of that, but in general, you've got a list of legitimate transport operators with the LTFRB. If you're not legitimate, you don't have a franchise, you're not going to get the subsidy. So it's not as hard as people make it sound. It's just that you're going to be weeding out the people who don't have legitimate franchises, who are not really playing fair anyway, because the legitimate guys are the ones who have to go through to get the licenses and all that. So it's fair that they're the ones who get the help.
Okay, you've heard the criticisms also. Mr. Rahan of Piston earlier said they're not so keen on the subsidy. They believe it's, well, of course, you admit it's a temporary measure. Professor Diokno of the UP School of Economics saying that, you know, subsidies, it's not a very good idea. Let's look at other doable and more long-term solutions. Flexible VAT on oil.
All right. The president has told the economic team to get their heads together and come out with other measures that can help over the short term. We know that fuel prices are likely to stay where they are. They might even go up. So what other measures can we put in place? The economic team is working on that, and in a matter of days, I think they'll have some concrete proposals for the president to consider. But the president says, put everything on the table, consider everything. I want the pros and cons. Give me a menu of choices. Give me the pros and cons, and let's decide together. And that's what the economic team is working on right now. So it's not gonna end with pantawid pasada. In fact, as we've always said, it's a temporary solution. Now, I've heard your guests also say that we have to think of a long-term plan, and everybody's saying that fuel prices are likely to go up over the next several years, and I agree with that. If you look at the reserve of oil that the world probably has, we've got maybe about 75 years worth of oil that we can consume at the current rates. So at some point, that's going to run out. Mm-hmm. So what are we going to do about it? We have it in place, a long-term solution. I don't know where, I don't know what section of the newspaper these guys are reading, because they're obviously not reading the front pages, and they're not watching the news, because mm-hmm. we've announced it already. Over the next 5 years, we plan to shift public transport vehicles, tricycles, buses, jeepneys, from diesel and gas to alternate fuels. We launched the 20 tricycles in Mandaluyong, they're mm-hmm. electric tricycles. That's going to be 20,000. Mm-hmm. And that's being piloted in Mandaluyong, but the other LGUs are already want, they already want to get in on it. Compressed natural gas, mm-hmm. Which we have a lot of in Malampaya, mm-hmm. Which does not move with oil prices, mm-hmm. is something that we're going to encourage public utility buses mm-hmm. to shift to over the next several years. Mm-hmm. The president wants to see, before the end of his term, substantially all public utility vehicles mm-hmm. running on some alternate fuel. Mm-hmm. That way, if mm-hmm. fuel goes up to $200 a barrel, it's not going to matter to us. Mm-hmm. The other thing about it is it's going to be cleaner for the air. In fact, pollution is probably going to significantly come down. So it's got environmental benefits. It's got economic benefits, because the tricycle driver who's spending 250 pesos for gas a day will spend the equivalent of about 50 pesos in terms of his electricity. He's going to make more money. He's going to have more money to bring home to his family. And there's going to be less pressure on him to raise prices. Mm-hmm. These are ambitious long-term plans that we've announced already that some people don't seem to want to acknowledge.
Operative words being ambitious.
But it's okay. Out there. Mm-hmm. We do have to be ambitious. Linda, in Brazil, they said, the government of Brazil 10, 15 years ago said, look, we're going to be the biggest ethanol producer in the world. We're going to free ourselves from high oil prices by going into ethanol. People in Brazil said, oh, hindi nila kaya yan, hindi natin kaya yan. But what did they do? They have become the largest ethanol producer. Mm. Their cars run on ethanol. All their cars run on ethanol. I'm saying if Brazil can do it, we can do it. And we can do it in less time.
Well, okay, you mentioned ethanol. I was going to say alternate fuels in general. Ethanol, we seem to have a few bumpy. We've had that how many years ago with the Clean Air Act. But, you know, problems with producing, some affecting food production, also sugarcane production and all that. So we're not exactly